the Georgetown Literary Festival this afternoon. Aliens, birdmen, and other beings bringing characters to life on the stage and screen. I'm your moderator this afternoon. My name is Ezra Zaid. Let me introduce you to our panelists. The full description of what they've achieved and what they've done can be seen in the program. To my left is Nandita Solomon, film producer and co-founder of an indie film production company here in Malaysia. Sitting next to her is Mahesh Dattani, acclaimed playwright and stage director, screenwriter, filmmaker from India. Next to him is Prabda, a writer, translator, and publisher from Thailand. And finally, all the way to the left, A.S. Hardy Shafii, a theater director. He was trained as an actor and currently is the Deputy Dean of Research Graduates and Linkages at the School of Arts at USM. If I can trouble you for a big round of applause for our panelists sharing their insights this afternoon. Oh, all right. A lot of enthusiasm. As mentioned, guys, we're going to have just a chat about characters. You guys know a lot more about this than I do, so I'm hoping that you'll fill in the gaps to my questions. I think each and every one of you are creators of these different characters. And in trying to shape them, in trying to craft them for each particular story that you're writing. But I think first and foremost, all of you are also fans of fiction. You guys are reading books, you're watching film. When you start reading those first opening pages and look at those first opening scenes, what are the type of characters that draw you in? What are the types of characters that you personally get excited about? This is what they do. They go, no, 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 no.
That's silence, trans. Yeah. Well, I don't know the different things. I think the character has to intrigue me. And I feel that the characters which have contradictions and the opening pages, if they promise, propose something about the character which sort of piques your interest and you want to know a little bit, like, I think every story is a mystery. I think a conundrum which you're trying to figure out. And so I think if it proposes that mystery, then to me that's engaging. It engages me and I want to know more. I want to invest my time and emotions in you know, in the character's plight then.
Yeah I think that's
good.
The what Mahesh has finished with, the character's plight, I think I'm more fascinated when like terrible things are happening to your character and they have to kind of journey through that and then discover themselves more. So it's the characters who have like an inner turmoil, a conflict, self-doubt that they're trying to overcome, and like where what you see is not what you eventually discover through the journey. Those are the compelling characters.
Yeah, so I'm hearing, you know, conflict, turmoil, contradictions. Prabda, did that seem something that you would say as well?
I tend to be drawn towards characters that are contradictory in his or her personality. Somebody who seems nice but has a really dark side, things like that. Or also another type of character I'm drawn to is a contrarian. Somebody who is always feeling like he or she doesn't belong or doesn't fit in a certain situation or a certain society. But having said that, I think I'm also sort of tired of being drawn to the same characters all the time. So I try also to write about people that I generally wouldn't be interested in or know particularly. So I'm curious about other characters as well, but in the end, for some reason, I'm always back to the kid in the back or the guy in the corner or the woman who doesn't want to be there anymore, that kind of thing.
Hadi, I'm wondering, just with what Prabda mentioned, sometimes when we watch certain characters on screen or when we read them in a book, we identify with them because maybe that's a slight reflection of a part of ourselves. Is that also something that's quite important?
Yeah, it could be true, but in regards to my, my so-called this creation to the characters, because sometimes we need to represent, because some of my characters actually invented because of, I think they need a voice. These are marginalized society, people who are being abused, people who are being sidelined. So I think based on these characters, and some, most of them actually passed away, some of the characters in my productions, and they need a voice. And to look at that perspective, so I was talking to Mahesh just now about the notion of truth. For instance, during 60s and 70s, the persona was regarded as a leftist. But now, in this context, now she's a hero. So it's interesting to see the truth can be manipulated even. So you can do that and use the characters to submerge this kind of issues.
Throughout this afternoon, we're going to be talking about characters and how they reflect and serve the story. But maybe before we get to that, maybe you guys can talk to me a little bit about some of characters that you've seen on film or stage or in literature, some of the characters that have had an impact on you. It could be a character from a film that you just watched last week, but are there some memorable characters that have in some way impacted your creative process as well?
Well, my mind is creaking right now to pick up an example. I saw an adaptation of actually a play from Malaysia called Emily of Emerald Hill. I don't know how familiar people are with it. It's a solo piece. And I think the playwright is either Singaporean or Malaysian. And it just it starts off with her just giving sets of instructions to her servants whom we don't see, right? And immediately you're sucked into her world, which is created just by the kind of instructions she's giving to her relatives and to her friends' children, and saying, oh, don't put your daughter in ballet. She has to spread her thighs and it's going to, so music is fine, let her learn the piano, right? So immediately there's something very rich about the character. You know exactly what she's thinking, and I want to know more about her. So that was one play that comes to mind, which drew me in right from the first action on stage. Nandita, are you ready?
I'll just share about, actually I'm rereading a book I read about 20 years ago, The Confederacy of Dancers, and it's the main character who drives the whole story is such an unappealing guy. Like, if you knew this person in real life, you'd want to go and slap him twice. But it's just the way that he's been written and all these horrible things he does to the people around him by being completely clueless. And it's the way that he's been written that you just kind of, you're in there with him, empathizing from his point of view. And I love that, like, that's so outside my world, and I get to kind of be in the driver's seat of somebody else's life. I get to run away and live a fantasy, be somewhere else, someone else, you know.
What's so fascinating is about some of these characters that are perhaps despicable, they have values that you just completely don't agree with, but it's so fascinating when you can empathize with them. And if you start empathizing with the character, there's this relationship that happens between the viewer and the character.
I think, actually, there are so many characters that you actually inspired of. For instance, if you watch The Remains of the Day, Kazuo Ishiguro, when you watch Anthony Hopkins as a butler in the movie, and with the political situation at the same time, and because of his post at the same time, people actually segregate in terms of your social status, and you sort of empathize as him as a butler, and because it's actually influenced his manner, his views, because he actually been dictated by his position as a butler. So you can actually, when you look at this character, you see it, and how the director and how the writer put this kind of character, not because of to show huge, huge distinction between the upper classes and the working class, but actually looking at the social political agenda at the same time and about race, occupation in the UK at the same time. So it's actually inspired people to look from his perspectives. So I think it's great to watch a character something like that.
Prabda, do you have one?
I was going to say something really similar. I've always felt that the characters that I like or that interest me in literature, in film, are the ones that usually, probably you don't want to know. Like, really annoying characters, like, you know, like the Woody Allen character in all Woody Allen films.
Right.
You can't sit there and listen to this guy, really. I mean, it's really annoying. But because of the absurdity of the character, because of the comical quality of these situations and characters, I think they draw you in and they sort of reflect the complexity of life and you know, like situations that you encounter. So for example, the character in Catcher in the Rye also. This is a very annoying young man, you know? And as you grow older, you go back to reread the story, you feel like, why did I ever like this guy? But you like him when you was 12, when you were 13, because you feel, you sort of sympathize with him, even though you have no experiences that he has. But as you grow older, you feel like what is important in real life is to sort things out and to, you know, be content or feel okay with your life or whatever. But this guy just doesn't want to do that. And you feel like you just want to grab him by the neck and be like, you know, get over it. But when you read something, I think you become attracted to things that maybe you... It's just a strange situation or strange character.
I want to talk a little bit about the creative process for each and every one of you, because I think there are some budding writers and playwrights and screenwriters in the room. And I guess we start to research maybe the character. What's his occupation? What's his culture? What is the context he or she is living in? You start thinking about creating those details around their environment. You develop this backstory, and then you establish their relationships. I mean, that's something that I imagine one does, but the creative process doesn't work necessarily in such a fluid way. How does it work for you guys when you're starting to frame a story? Do you start with the plot? Do you start with the story? Do you start with figuring out who these characters are first and then weave them into it? What's that process like? None of them want to answer any questions.
Okay, while they flesh out their thoughts, I'll do my disclaimer here. I'm not like a real writer like these guys. I'm actually a creative producer. So I work with writers a lot in shaping the stories and giving a lot of feedback. And actually, I'm the lead researcher as well in terms of what the writer in shaping the story. And on the latest film we've done, I get a writer's credit because I actually came in and put some real stuff into that. But yeah, slightly different from these guys, but part of the process.
You're coming in later in the process.
No, I come in early enough. Like, I work very closely with Dane, so okay, let's take it from there. How did we work on Bunohan or Interchange? He has these, so I don't, it all doesn't come just from me. I'm working with somebody else. So he'll have this, like, he knows the ending of the story, he can see the beginning, he can see these points that happen, and then he's very clear, like, at least minimum three characters, this is what his story is going to be about. That's when we start doing all the research and talking about what else do we need, and slowly growing that world. And because Dane is very visual, a lot of times that world is already set.
Right.
You know, so and because it's film, it's three-dimensional in a way, so we're actually moving in this space. So say, for example, for the next film that he wants to work on, he's written a treatment, and his world is so strong. Like, you can already imagine the streets and the sidewalks, and it's fictional. It's not really there. So I guess that's how we connect. When he shows it to me and I can imagine it, and I can be there, then we're like, okay, we're going to make this film, you know?
What's interesting about that is that the world gets that primary treatment first, and then after that, these characters start filling up the spaces.
Yeah, I guess that's how we're working. I'm not going to assume it's the same thing for everyone else.
Well, because I write for stage and film, my audience is actually someone like Nandita, because with film, you have to narrate. At least that's how it is in India. Very, very few people actually read treatments. You actually have to go there and tell them what the story is about. And I think that's a very good thing. Because storytelling for film or stage, it's a temporal art. So how you write it may not really come across to a creative producer, right? So even as you're narrating it, it becomes a performance, because you have a bouncing board. You're seeing whether the person is interested, whether they're making eye contact, or whether they're checking their messages or whatever.
It's almost like an elevator pitch. In the first 2 minutes, if their eyes start wandering off, then
exactly.
The story's
done. I think the pitch does more than sell you your... of course, the selling part is very important, because you've already sussed out how much the contract is worth. And you don't wanna, But I think where the pitching helps is, you know whether your story has a spine or not. Within 2 minutes, if you can't tell the essence of your story, and the question that comes after that, if you don't have it on the tip of your tongue, you don't know the world of your story well enough to actually write it.
There's something also about when people are pitching stories, that if you can articulate your log line of what that story is in a couple of sentences, as you mentioned, if you get that spine right, after that it's just gravy.
Yeah, well, of course, there's a lot of hard work after that.
A little bit
but
after,
it has a spine.
That's right.
Yeah.
Oh, me. It's interesting because I do a device play whereby we don't have a script. And I share with my actors on the characters, and they do their own homework based on pictures, based on listening to music, sound. And I encourage them to write. And of course, not all actors can write. Some of them actually quite scared because they never ventured into writing. But actually, for me, it's very refreshing to see, because they actually research on the character, and they need to so-called write, and because of they sort of know the character, they study the characters, and they should actually immerse so-called in the truth of the character. So they try to write. And of course, I just guide them and rehearse the line and whether it fits or whether it suits to the situations. Then we discuss about it. And of course, not all of them actually can excel as a writer. They can't write. But to encourage them to encourage them to write and to say out loud their own text. So it's part of the play, because they are the writers too. And for me, just to guide and edit, and it's on and on and on and edit and edit. So that's how it works in terms of how the text come out to the play.
Prabda, do you feel like you need to intimately know the character from the get-go, or does that character change and evolve as those drafts keep on churning out?
Usually I start with knowing the initial... motivation of a character. So and I like to start with a setting as well. I like to focus on like a small territory rather than a larger one. For example, if I write about a city or something, I would prefer to write about situations that happen in a small bar or a small apartment or something like that in that city, and then having the characters sort of paint the other parts of the larger picture by their characters or by their conversations or by the situations that they encounter. So I usually prefer like really small situation and dialogue between characters rather than showing detailed picture of to compare it to painting, I think I'm more of a sketch artist than a mural artist. I don't, maybe because I'm lazy, but but I'm more drawn towards that.
You know, I'm curious about in this creative and writing process, because everything gets better after the second, the third, and the fourth edit. But there's a line of thought that if you intimately know your character, it's less about you writing out what he or she is going to say or what they're going to react to or where they're going to go. It's more about you tuning in into a signal of who that character is, and the character eventually tells the writer what's going to happen next. Is that kind of how it works, or is it not so straightforward?
It can be straightforward, but it's a lot of hard work. Because to have that intimate relationship with your character, you have to know your character in the sense of the reality of that character, where that character is. Where is that character coming from? And I think the more you know your character, the greater the chances of that interaction happening, so that even you could be surprised at what your character does. But it's a lot of hard work to get to that stage. And there are just a few occasions where that has happened to me. I think it's a question of preparation. It's like homework. It's like doing your homework so you're ready for the unpredictable. So when the unpredictable happens, you have choices that go beyond the generic choices or choices you would personally make. And that requires a fair amount of homework in knowing your character, know in the sense of knowledge of your character. So knowing in a sense of the details and the world and the time where your character is from.
Nandita, I love that thing about what Mahesh was mentioning about having options just in case something doesn't work out with that character as a story develops. Why is that so important within that process? Is it because, I guess, it's not necessarily something that is set out in stone that is the way that you want to tell a story? There are all these different branches, especially in film, between pre-production, production, and post-production, that character can sort of evolve and change, or is it pretty much set in stone?
Sorry, I just want to clarify what I meant by having options. It's not a question of when something isn't working out that, okay, let me pull something out. I think at every stage, your character's making choices. Mm. And to have, those options, and something in that moment will speak to you and say, this is the choice your character makes.
And that's totally true in our experience, and that's usually like when I get a draft from Dane, it's in black, and then he's like, and then the red is like option A, and all the green is option B, and it's until option F, and then that's kind of, then I'll be like, okay, Dane, this is not going to make sense, because further on, it's going to affect the decisions your character is making here, and then that's going to stop him from making that decision he needs to make at this point, so he needs to make this one, so you can start going this way. But when you get into, like, say, after the shoot and the edit, your character's not going to be, like, from a questioner, he's not going to turn right into the antagonist. Like, that's not going to happen. Those choices aren't going to change like that, no. But one thing you said earlier was, like, about, like, you tap into frequencies. I think, for me, that's how it is. Like, whichever writers that we're working with, I really want to know that they don't have any other jobs or what their other jobs are, so that they give this dedicated time to it. I really believe that writing is kind of organic, and that they do write themselves. They take you on the journey, and you have to, it's a bit like a spiritual, metaphysical experience almost, this act of creation. And I consider it almost holy, and I give the writers that space. Like, don't come to the office. You like to write in your bathroom, just stay there and do it. Like, whatever works for you. If you need 2 weeks to just sit and stare at the wall and nothing is happening in your head, well, do that
do
too.
That.
But yeah, meet the deadline, okay? Yeah. But whatever it takes to get you to that point, I really feel it's really, really important. And in terms of shaping characters, I'll use one example that happened on Interchange. Dane and another writer had worked on the script for 2 years, and it was going and going, and something just wasn't working. It was a crime thriller, and you know, and they had an antagonist who was very strong in the whole film, but somehow this antagonist line was there, and the other characters were kind of struggling to breathe a bit. So we said, okay, you guys take a break, let me see what I can do. And I took out the antagonist completely through the whole script, just kind of ripped out this one character. And it was really quite interesting what happened to the space of the story then with this gap, and whether we could work the story without an antagonist and then shape it and look at it differently. It was quite an interesting process to go through, and I'm quite glad we did, so we can say that now we know what happens, like, that you can do stuff like that, what it feels like.
Yeah, in creating, from my point of view, in creating a device space, it's always very interesting because I myself do not know where it begins and where it ends, and most of the actors which are not used to a device space would be freaked out. It's like, what's going to happen? But we have a Google Drive whereby everybody can just check online. You just add in, and everybody can see what's going on, and we sort of like just text and what's happening. Like, okay, I'll just add this, so everybody can look at it, and it's actually prosper from there. And it can be from the scene one and scene three, scene four. So you can see the development sometimes starting from scene three, and then it gets bigger and bigger. And for me, just to monitor and edit at the same time. And they say, oh my God, Dr. Hardy just cut my line. So they can see what's going on. And it's actually, it's very refreshing. It's very interesting to see they write, to encourage them to write. So I think that's how the whole process, but it's actually very unpredictable. And even a month before the performance, we don't know what's going to happen. So I think that's very thrilling for me.
Prabda, do you have this intimate relationship with your characters?
Probably not intimate enough, but you know, when you write, logic has, you know, like you work with logic a little bit. But I find it also interesting when surprises happen. Meaning that sometimes you think like this type of character would do this, do that, or this situation should unfold in a certain way, but if you sort of change it or try to make it twist it a little bit or make it surprising, sometimes it works better than to make it as it would be otherwise. Because I remember this really well when I started out writing a screenplay. The director was telling me how a couple of my scenes were not believable enough because there would be some, I think he gave a very extreme example. He said if we were sitting in a Starbucks and there was a woman dressed as a Native American somewhere in a corner, it would be really weird and not realistic. But that example sort of made me think like, no, that's totally realistic. Sometimes you see even more like weirder things, you know, in Starbucks especially. But so I think that kind of thing is, you know, adds to a story. But of course you can't write like there's a dinosaur in Starbucks. But surprises can work really well. And I personally find stories with this kind of surprise more interesting.
Mahesh, you mentioned something about something being realistic or believable. So how do writers make ordinary characters exciting? And in the same sense, how do you make extraordinary characters believable? Because I think that is always a tension that happens as well.
Right. May I? Yeah, I think when we talk about... Okay, let me talk about the theater because we talked about film. When we say realism, I would say that realism is a convention too in the theater. There's no such thing as real. It's an artifice. It's an art. So when we talk about truth, we're talking about the truth that belongs to the world you have created. So in that sense, it doesn't have to be, verisimilitude in the sense it doesn't have to be a direct reflection of day-to-day lives. So when we talk about ordinary people, that's also a convention. you give the illusion that this person is a salesman and an ordinary person who goes about his business, but what an extraordinary life. Yeah, you could write a drama about and in a very surreal way. You can have that salesman talk to his dead brother, and it can be very real as well. So I think it comes back to how well can you enter the world of your characters, and what's the grammar you create for that world. To give you a very obvious example would be something like Avatar, the film, is that how well do you create this planet? You know, how well do you know the language of this planet? How well do you know the physicality of these people on the planet and things? And that becomes very real then.
I think that goes back again about setting the world to be believable and then making everything else accessible, I guess, to the audience as well. Is there this realism thing about tapping it into real life? Because we're talking about fiction a lot, but non-fiction informs us a lot. And is there an element of sharing that as well, to be truthful to your true life experiences and translating that to a fictional piece of work?
It's something I wonder too, especially with other writers. How do you write experiences that you personally didn't have? So I think the limitation is really in your mind. You need not necessarily have lived through those things or done those things. I mean, obviously, whoever wrote Spider-Man did not live life as Spider-Man, you know? But to have that, it's about imagination, and it's about the freedom of the mind to really go into these places and allow yourself in there. I don't know any other way to say it.
Yeah, that's a challenge, isn't it? Because it's a limitation that you want to break, but you want to break it in an honest and an effective way as well.
Right. I was going to say that usually the emotional core of your writing comes from you. I think that's, and it can be so oblique, like Shakespeare wrote Hamlet after he lost his son, right? But Hamlet is not about losing a son, it's about losing a father. So you could see how the personal can go into the imaginative to create a great work. Steven Spielberg said that E.T. was actually a journey back into his own childhood when he would imagine these extraterrestrials coming and had, would let his imagine. So there is something very personally. That's why E.T. was such a big hit. When you do this guaranteed surefire success kind of thing, the chances are it's going to fail. So I don't think we can undermine the personal. I'm very glad we're talking about the nuts and bolts of writing, because people have too much of a romantic idea about writing. It's a lot of hard work. And it's a very writing for film is a very humbling experience, let me tell you. You could be sort of toned down, and it's not meant to be personal. I mean, everyone is just as interested in you to make things work. For example, if Shakespeare were to take Hamlet to a creative producer today, that'll be good fun.
That's a great conversation.
Yeah, the first thing they would say is, okay, that monologue is too long. You know, just to be or not to be is enough. We get the point. You know, don't need to write anything more. Or the ghost works. People love ghosts. Get us more of the ghosts. Yeah. You know.
Yeah. Brother, I mean, just going on that note about putting the personal onto a page, there's a lot of pressure and there's a lot of insecurity about whether that cuts the mustard, not just for you as a writer and as a creative person, but to be judged, you know, by an audience as well. Is it easy to stay true to this process of who you believe this character is? Because there are tendencies to want to make the character in a certain way, or to make them likable, or to make them to appease the audience. Is it challenging to keep true to what you want the character to be?
I'm sure each writer is different in that regard, but for me, that's why I write. I mean, I write because I cannot express myself well in real life. So this is my way of telling my parents what I think, telling my friends how I am, telling the world, you know, like what I think about everything. So it's very personal, yes, but it's not hard for me because that's my only way to be truly myself, you know. So for me, it was a challenge in the beginning to sort of expose myself like that in my writing. But once it, you know, once I had readership, once I knew that people were okay with what I was writing about, then it became much easier. And now I just, you know, I'm not writing about myself, but probably if you want to know me, you can find details in my
some
characters.
Elements of it.
Yes.
Hadi, of course, you know, you work at the School of Arts at USM, and you know there are a lot of young writers who want to tell great, big, grand stories, but they just haven't lived life enough to articulate that imagination. How do young writers break that element that allows them to write in an honest way?
I think, well, this is a tricky question. I think it's not that easy, of course, but I need to encourage them to understand it's not only about the character. They have to understand social context. They have to understand, in terms of theatre, you need to understand you have all this paraphernalia. You have even costume to understand. You have a makeup. You have props that actually will enrich the character. So I think for my case, my students normally just tackle on the character, tackle on the story, but sometimes they're struggling to relate with the economy, the socio-political history. So I think that is the, also philosophy and laws and whatnot, and policy whatsoever. So they have to connect with all these other sources to enrich the characters. I think not only to understand the cycle, the ego, superego of the character, but also to understand surroundings. I think that would actually encourage them to understand more, and also in relation to the other characters.
In each story, there are certain archetypes that are employed to serve the story. How important is it that they are used effectively? Because there's a protagonist, there's an antagonist, there's a villain, there's a hero. How do you use them in a way that serves the story? Just maybe to draw on from some of your own respective works, because we all like them because we're waiting to see them as the page turns. You have a feeling that that's where it's going to turn. How do you employ them effectively?
Well, if you're truthful to what you're writing, you will have archetypes, which just means that the human nature hasn't changed ever since civilization. That's what it means. I don't know, I could be wrong. Like he said, every writer is different. I really think it's important to focus on the specificities of your character and the character's world, right? Whether it's a setting, whether it's the time, whether it's what the character's position is at that point. And the archetypes will appear. And I think, yeah, great stories all rely on archetypes. I think, the archetype in Bollywood is like boy meets girl and papa says no, right? Now, if you say, I'm going to write a story about boy meets girl and papa says no, and I'm going to present these archetypes, you're not going to get a story. But your story just might have these archetypes, and that's okay. You can still make something very original and beautiful with that. I mean, if you look at Romeo and Juliet, or if you look at Mughal-e-Azam, or if you look at, the latest Shah Rukh Khan, they all have boy meets girl, papa says no, right? But they're all very very original pieces of writing, and the characters are so memorable.
Nandita, you're going to do a boy meets girl and Papa Says No type story? Is that your next piece of work?
Only if the boy is a bird man, then you know, we might talk about it. But this thing about archetypes, I think I'd just like to say, because we meet a lot of young people who want to write and, you know, they bring their scripts in, and sometimes it's, you have to live life. I think that's a really big part of the creative process as well, and being able to write good characters. So one of the most important components of this research, so it's not that moment that you're researching for that story that you're writing, it's probably everything you've done before and your approach to life, and to go out and meet people, because you can't expect to go and do all these different things, but if you just are a good observer and you listen to people and you hear other people's stories, that's what you can really tap into when you're creating your characters and when you're deciding, should my character open the right door or should he go and water the plant now? Like, it really comes back into those things. So if all you know are archetypes, if all you've done is like watch the Hollywood movies, and then now you want to write a script and all you know your reference are these archetypes, you're going to get a very flat script, a flat story that's not going to go anywhere. So at the end, I'm just mirroring back what he said in a different kind of way, that it's the human component is really important.
Yeah, because if you do an archetype, if you employ it within the story effectively, it's a great, interesting thing. But if you do it in a lazy manner, then it's just a stereotype. And you fall into that as well, don't you?
I think when you analyze it, it's interesting. But when you work, you have to pretend like you don't know any of these archetypes. And because in the end, something is going to, you know, be similar to something.
Something's going to get.
Even if, you know, boy meets cat, it's still a relationship.
Yeah.
You know, so you can't worry about that too much. Because your story, even though it's similar to some other story, is your story. And there's going to be something different in that if you work on it hard enough. We see examples of really bland formulas all the time, like in Hollywood movies, you can sort of deconstruct all these romantic comedies to, it's actually basically just one movie. You know, they just change the names of the characters, they change the professions of the character, whatever, but in the end, it's pretty much the same, and that's boring. But you can use that archetype to experiment with it. You can be experimental with these archetypes, I think.
All right, folks. The nice lady in the corner has waved her hand at me, and so it's time for question and answers. If you have a question, raise your hand, and somebody will get a microphone to you. We've got one question in the front right here, and we've got another one right next to him. We've got another one there. Okay, there you go. Two gentlemen. Yep.
Hello. Hi, my name is Ray Buono, and I'm an acting coach. And really, what I'm interested in is that all of you have to transfer your characters into performances, whether on stage or screen, and that means you have to deal with performers. So what process do you use? How much do you give the actor in terms of developing the character? And what kind of actors do you like to work with?
It's a very complicated relationship with actors, and directors as well. Again, it's been, like one playwright put it well, he said, it's like handing over your baby to a band of gypsies. And, you know, and you meet your child many years later, and you cannot recognize that child anymore. But I think, having said that, I think it's an element of trust, because I feel that earlier on I would want to control how my play would be interpreted by directors and actors, and I would overwrite them, and I would do that, and that actually just weakened my plays. And I think if I don't trust the director, I have the choice of not giving them the play to do it. And I think most often than not, the directors and the actors have surprised me with interpretations that I didn't think were in my script. I think it's a question of trust, and to understand that you may, as a playwright, you may begin the creative process, but it doesn't end with you. That it's always a process. And I think it may be true of performers as well, with audiences, that, you know, how do audiences take in performances, and how is that? So to respond to your question about transferring to actors and what I think of actors, I think most actors are egocentric. I think they're selfish, and I would not want to have dinner with them. But they're very talented. And they do take my plays forward. And I need them, yes. Because I think the more talented the actor is, I think the more selfish they are. I think it just goes with the territory. But of course, I know great actors are the ones who can continue with that creative collaboration on stage with audiences and co-actors. But in reality, and from my experiences, most of them are very selfish, but they're also very talented.
Yes. In my case, most of my actors are not used to physical theater. And some of my actors, they are a traditional theater performers, so they're not used to stylized acting. So it's not easy to break them, but they must let themselves to be broken. It's a long process, because you need them to understand the training, because the training is different, and they need to be encouraged in order to break them. So sometimes you have professional actors, sometimes you have those who are not familiar with your style, so you just need to adjust, and because you just need to understand, and you just need to identify their strength rather than their weakness. I think that is the most important thing, apart from the trust between these two.
Let's move on to another question.
In about 25 minutes, there's going to be a panel here on cultural appropriation, which is something you all need to stay for, but. That's what
you're
I wanted.
Plugging your own show.
I know. It's called a forward sell. But this is what I wanted to ask
what
you
I
guys.
Mean about selfish.
But this is what I wanted to ask you guys. What is your process when it comes to creating characters that aren't you, that are the other, that often can run the risk of you being accused of appropriating from another culture, that is often and I say this without judgment, at a lower level than yourself. Because we can appropriate up and no one has a problem with it. But when we appropriate down, we get into a lot of trouble. So talk to me about creating those characters.
And in 25 minutes, there's a panel about cultural appropriation. So stay tuned for that. But yeah, that's a great question.
I think a lot of the writing process is about appropriation, you know? So, because you're borrowing, you're taking from so many different references and influences and memories and things like that. But so there is bound to be a level of cultural appropriation, but I guess it's cultural appropriation is a political act, isn't it? So if that's your intention, then it's going to scar your work. Or if you're ignorant that you're doing it, it's also going to affect your work. And it's that self-awareness, what your political consciousness. If you don't have it, then you might think it's fine to do something and not realize that you're putting down somebody else or not treating them with equal respect. So.
Well, if you ask about appropriation, I think history is the biggest appropriator. I think it pretends to be factual, but it's appropriating facts. Whereas fiction is about telling great stories. So I disagree with the word appropriation. I would use the word creation.
Any other thoughts?
Of course, I think we both probably, I mean, all of us probably have that. It's the same experience and dilemma on how to project and how to express. Based on my experience, for instance, in Singapore, when we performed Teo Beng Hock's story, because I have to protect my students in terms of the performance, because you know it's quite sensitive, but interestingly, audience and also delegates from the Philippines, they understand what it's all about. So I'm not so sure whether it's the right to appropriate and whether it's the right platform to express your concern, but in the end of the day, it's the creation, it's the creative creation that you just put. It's in an open book, and it's up to the audience to summarize whether it's right or wrong. But of course, it's always a dilemma. It's always a conflict whether you think it is right or it is wrong. But I think the audience will decide later on what they have seen.
I think you're trying to do research for your panel on Ezra's panel.
We've got a question, a young man, I think he wants to make a film or something, that one, yeah.
Thank you. I'd just like to ask all of you, when do you stop? When do you know when to stop? I guess there's two ways to look at stopping. You're going to stand outside and look at it from outside. But when you look... Hello? Yeah, when you look at it from inside, I guess it's a kind of closure.
When do you know how to stop? When do you let go?
Well, that's, I think, where theatre and cinema differ greatly. That in theatre, I think it's always a process. I really don't know when to stop because, you know, productions are done, something's not working, something's tossed out, you want to if I revisit a play I'd written 2 years ago, I want to rewrite it. Whereas I think with film, that is not possible. It's sort of literally set in stone after the first edition is out. So in terms of when writing the story, you mentioned something interesting. You said personally, like from a personal point of view. I really don't know. Yes, you know, sometimes you do find a resolution and you feel the story is complete. But somewhere, personally, I'm never quite sure that it's over.
It's kind of hard to explain, but for me, it's more about how I stop when I feel that the characters that are important to me come to a kind of resolution, but the audience or the readers don't. I stop when I feel like I leave it at a moment when the characters sort of understand what's going on, but the readers have to continue to imagine what's happening afterwards. So I like to leave a little bit of mystery after the ending. So I end just where it's confusing enough.
Yeah, just enough confusion, but just enough closure.
Just enough confusion, just enough mystery to want to continue to think about the story afterwards.
Nandita, do you know when to stop?
In our experience so far, no, we've never actually reached a point in our working process where we can sit back comfortably and say, oh, I think we're done. It's always been like pushing, because we're always fighting against time and the money. And by the time the financing is finally raised and then we're trying to get the script closed and we've got so much going on, it's always insane. And it's always like in the last few days before or like during pre-production even. And at the point that I'll come in and say, I think we can stop here, is when I feel that whatever happens now with what we have, we've tried to rectify as many holes, as many gaps, as much of the logic tying in, the believability of the characters and what's happening to them. I think we can make a film with what we have here. We're going, you, like, go and like we need to start rolling now because the clock is ticking, so we need to shoot now. And then I guess as the producer working with the director from the start, it doesn't end until the editing, because the script, yeah, the story keeps going and it's really handed over to everybody else along the line, from the actors to the editor to the composer, and that's when it's done, like there.
At some point it's done, yeah. We've got room for one more question. Okay, this lady here.
Hi. Can you guys recall one instance, one specific plot point or a character or a scene that stopped you up, that you couldn't move past for a while, and then how you dealt with it?
How you dealt with it? Any kind?
Like a writer's block.
Writer's block. So that there's a character that you just can't close off, yeah. Have any of you had writer's block, ladies and gentlemen?
I guess, yeah, it's a bit too personal to talk about, but since you raised the question, yeah, there was a play which I felt a little too close to the character and what the character was going through, and I had to put a stop to it and take a break. Fortunately, it was a play, so you know I'm a little bit more in control over deadlines with plays. But if you're writing for cinema, you don't have that luxury. The people breathing down your back and saying, you know, when is it coming? So you can't afford to have writer's block then.
I don't recall, but I'm sure I will find them in a folder on my laptop.
There's a story that's
all
not completed.
All the documents that are unfinished, yeah. 2 pages long, they're all in there, but I blocked them out.
You've blocked out your writer's block?
Yes.
All right. Folks, we've got questions. Just room for one more question, quick one, and then after this, you guys can storm the stage and ask your own personal question, but go for it.
Okay, thanks. There's a really famous quote where art is not a mirror held up to reality, but a hammer which to shape it, by Brecht. Yes. Right. But we talk about stories and linking them with our lives and like using our experiences to like create like archetypes stories that are different and not make a stereotype. But what if you try and combine the elements of Brechtian theater where you don't really have characters that you must love, you don't really have a story but more of a message? How would you link your experiences, like your story, your life, into projecting your message, a critical message, for example, like Donald Trump shouldn't be president? How do you do that?
I think it's important to understand the concept of to alienate yourself, and I think it's a bit tricky if you want to present it in front of audience who probably having a difficulties to understand on what are you trying to say, because as a Brechtian actor, you don't need to know, I mean, you don't really need to go deeper into the character, like inner truth. But as long as the message is up there to be projected to the audience. In my case, I use folk songs to narrate the stories or the concept, rather than just give it straight to you. And you need to alienate yourself and make it satirical. You use the folk songs, for instance, in my case, I use the folk songs to narrate about what is actually going on in a satirical manner. So I think it's
trying to employ different devices.
Yes, yeah, you can use that.
Anybody got the last word?
If I go by feedback from my readers or from my audience or whatever, it's so it varies so much that I don't really, like, some people tend to understand my work a certain way, others a totally different way, you know, so it's so hard, like, you just have to work. I mean, like, I can't answer that question.
And that's probably as good as a note as we're going to get this afternoon. Ladies and gentlemen, big round of applause. Nandita Solomon, Mahesh Dattani, Prabda Yoon, and A.S. Hardy Shafii. My name is Ezra Zaid. Thank you very much.